Toolis Agusilina.
Cheer to my heart.
jasmine and rose. What's the summer with all its gay train? What's the splendor of autumn to those who've bartered their freedom for gain? Let the love of our land's sacred rights to the love of our people succeed. Let friendship and honor unite and flourish on both sides the Tweed. No sweetness the senses can cheer, which corruption and bribery bind. No brightness the sun can e'er clear, for honor's the sum of the mind. Let the love of our land's sacred rise to the love of our people succeed. Let friendship and honor unite and flourish from both sides the Tweed.
I'm Tom Corrigan, President of the Board of Trustees of the Irish American Archives Society of Cleveland, Ohio. And our mission, as many of you know, is to preserve and protect, and I dare say defend, the history of the Irish and their contributions in Cleveland, Ohio. Of course, that mission does not succeed without you. So we're very grateful for your participation today and all your past participation in the work of the Irish American Archives Society. When we realized we couldn't hold our annual Walks of Life dinner this year, for all the obvious reasons, we wanted to come for some other kind of event that we hope you would like, something that would connect our roots and our heritage and remind us of why the Irish American Archives Society is so important. And we think we have something very special and unique for you today. And we're just so glad that you joined us. You know, after all those wonderful faces and pictures and characters, the fact that you have to look at me for even a few moments is certainly a drag. But I want you to know that the program is just wonderful. Kevin Toolis, who is our wonderful guest today and the creator of the wonderful program you're about to see, is a writer, a filmmaker, a bardic poet. And he's about to debut for you a new work entitled Coming Home Again. It's a short film commissioned by the Irish American Archives Society with your support. Before screening the film, Kevin Toolis is going to talk for a while and provide some context for his new work, with our director, Margaret Lynch, the Society's executive director. But first, a special message from our presenting sponsor today, who we thank, the Honorable Edward F. Crawford, most recently United States Ambassador to Ireland. I'll be back.
This program is presented in honor of Catherine Healy Crawford. She immigrated from County Cork in 1925. Her son, Edward F. Crawford, a 2012 Walks of Life honoree, rose to become a CEO and ambassador to Ireland in one generation. And now we hope you enjoy the program.
Hello, everyone. I'm Margaret Lynch, executive director of the Irish American Archive Society, and I'm here to guide you through a conversation with Kevin Toolis, who's about to present his new film, Coming Home Again. And we'd like to welcome Kevin from AFO. Kevin, say hi.
Hello, everyone. It's great to be with you here. It's coming on night here, and I know it's in the afternoon in Cleveland, but it's still great to be here with you all.
Right. I think you've got a really interesting perspective on immigration and the experience of immigration, because you've kind of been an outsider your whole life. You've seen immigration from lots of different sides. Will you tell us a little bit about your journey? I know you live in a place now that bears your name, Dukanella Toolis. Can you tell us how you came from Dukanella Toolis forward to today? In a quick soundbite.
I suppose I remember really being a child, and we would, I grew up in Edinburgh. I was reared in Scotland, as people would say on the island. But both my mother and father are from Achill. And we would all pile in each summer, van journey, which my poor father was often the only adult male in the van. There were like lots of children, aunties, children who began almost from the word go, saying, you know, are we there yet? I'm going to be sick. Stop the car. I need to go to the toilet. And we would go this long journey through Scotland, through the middle towns of Ireland, to this country that we called the real Ireland once we crossed the border, because we drove through Northern Ireland. We would arrive just almost like the end of the universe. We'd arrive at the end of the continent in Dukanella, with all these stars above. And it was just this completely other place, but which was our place. Although as a child, I mean, I was only there in the summer, but it was this strange longing and acceptance. And like the old men in the village, who I thought were just incredibly old, they were only probably in their 50s. and also all my aunties, I seem to have like lots and lots of aunties who seem to know me. And they would always say this thing, they would say, welcome home. And I was like really shocked. How do you mean welcome home? But it was just this universal welcome. And I don't know of anywhere else in the world where you've ever held that feeling where people are just saying, you know, so old man, welcome home. And I just, wow. And then it was just this fabulous world of chickens and cows, milking cows and things like that, which were completely terrifying to this urban boy, and donkeys and haymaking. And we instantly took part in this life, really ancient life of haymaking and saving turf. My mother used to hire two donkeys, and we'd go up and all save turf together and have bottles of milky tea, you know, in lemonade bottles. And this thing about holy wells and just this other world, which was such an intrinsic part of our identity. And also because we were Achill Islanders, there was so many other people and relatives and part of that community. And most of the time in Edinburgh, my parents swam in a kind of sea of Achill Islanders. There were always like aunties coming to the house to talk. And I'd be really annoyed because I'd be turning up the TV and they're all be sort of chatting. But it was this world that we'd removed, you know, we lived in this kind of island, which was transplanted. And I suppose what you'll hear tonight in the poem is a reflection of that sense of exile and longing, of coming from an island of perpetual exile, where people still leave and where people have relatives all over the world. You can even see it in the death notices. Someone dies and then they'll have a brother in Cleveland and another brother in or sister in Australia or in London or in different, even different parts of Ireland. It'd be quite rare for whole families to be here. And it's not just this generation. It has gone on for so long. And obviously the seeds, as I say, scattered across the face of the earth in places like Cleveland, all over the world. So there's this strange thing about ACL in that it looks out to the world more so than I think it looks to Dublin. And that's a very unique, it's both in Mayo and in Donegal, but it's also part of history that often the Irish state really doesn't want to fess up to. You know, so many people left, even in the 1950s. I know in Tucanella, when I was a child, there were just two houses. Now there's 20 houses where there were just two houses. But in the 60s, basically the whole place is like falling apart. People were fleeing for the boats because of the economic circumstances. And that has happened to some degree, generation after generation. So it shaped the history here. And it also is reflected in Coming Home Again in the poem tonight.
Right. Kevin, you've done a lot of different things in your life. You were a journalist for a long time, reporting on intense conflicts, first the troubles in Northern Ireland and then terrorism across the world. And then now you've turned to something completely different, I would say, but how are they related? The things that you're doing now, the writing that you're doing now, I think maybe the death of your father seems to have been a catalytic experience. You wrote a book called My Father's Wake. How did that sort of connect those two parts of your life and bring you into the life that you're in now, the death of your father?
I suppose it was a sort of seminal moment. I would always say always knew I was a writer. And even when I was interviewing people, I remember once a tabloid photographer who I was working with in Gaza, he said, "Why are you asking so many questions?" You think as a reporter, you should be allowed to ask questions. But even the photographer said, "Well, why are you asking?" But then it was a moment. And I'd gone really on a whole journey to very violent places to understand how people dealt with death and cope with conflict. And then I was back in the village, back in my father's death room. He was dying of pancreatic cancer. And it was very near the moment of death, his moment of death. And then my aunt, our kind of Ban Kinsha, the kind of chief seer, it's 5 o'clock in the morning. She thought he was dying. And then she kind of struck up the rosary. What had happened is I had left the house and it was 5 o'clock in the morning. I was going to go down to the beach, part of this death vigil. And my 9-year-old nephew, Sean, ran after me and said, "You know, come quick, Kevin, he's going." And I went back into this little room, very small room, not much bigger than a prison cell. And then there were 10 people at the bottom of the bed watching this man die. And it was a bit of me still kind of shocked, like, who are these people? And I sort of knew their faces, was related to them in blood, but some of them I'd never really spoken to in my life. And I was like, why are they here? You know, who are these people? What's this about? And then we began to pray. And then, you know, as a Catholic child, it's like in your DNA, it's the one thing that you remember. And I suppose when the moment came, maybe on the third or fourth verse, where I'd stood there feeling slightly like a traitor in my Irish skin, not really connecting. And then I just started praying too. And I realized that really what these people were doing was like a kind of death lullaby, that they were cradling this man into death, a very familiar prayer, the last sound that he would ever hear. And it was a great act of grace, really. And it wasn't entirely personal that they would be doing that for everyone. And it was a very ancient rite. And I kind of, something kind of clicked and I thought, oh yeah. And I looked around, I thought, goodness, somebody should write about this. And I couldn't see anyone in the room. other than me as a writer. And so that's where my father's weight came from. It was both a burden and a responsibility, but also it is this, again, you'll see it a bit in the film, this seed reshapes and knows itself again. There's something that is actually carried on through generation, reaching so far back in history that we've forgotten its own origins. I mean, one of the most surprising things about the Irish wake, people say, why did the Irish do that? But the real question is, why did other people not do that? Because this is an ancient, here's a bit of classical Greek. I don't know too much Greek. But the last line of the Iliad, written by Homer in 750 BC, is Hors hoigam ipan tapan hectoros hippodamoia. Thus held a wake and funeral for Hector, tamer of horses. Written by Homer in 750 BC. And if you went, his description of the wake would be almost identical to any Irish wake that you could go to today. So this is this part of this whole kind of cultural legacy that runs back through Irish culture, through Celtic culture, that has been passed on from generation to generation. And in some shape or form, that kind of nexus of culture, even when its children move away from places like Achill or Donegal or other parts of Ireland, that seed finds itself, reshapes its form, and presents itself in various cultural artifacts, even here tonight as one of them.
Right, and I don't mean to be so prosaic after, but then you moved back to Dukenella. You know, you came back home, this experience brought you back home. You've been doing these filmed poems. I think there's sort of a new genre almost, because the melding of the poetry and the film is so perfect. You've created one of those filmed poems for us here today. Would you like to tell us a little bit about that before this particular piece that we're going to see before we hit play?
Well, it's not really a new form, because bardic poetry is like, basically it's the original Game of Thrones. If you didn't have a TV projector or a cinema, you're back in the day and we're all sitting around, then this is the sort of art form of the word, of the human word, which is not, I mean, I've been to kind of few poetry readings and, you know, the poet reads something out, they're reading it from a book, and then they kind of look up and say, oh, shall I read another one? But bardic poetry is, you know, you have to learn it from memory. You have to perform, you kind of engage with the audience. As, you know, coming home again is not the Iliad, which is 11,000 words and was a great, you know, was a continual blockbuster, but it's the notion that you're performing it and reciting it and engaging. And that also, it's not just the story of an individual. It is the story of a people. It's the word made out loud of, well, this is our story. So what I hope tonight when you see in Coming Home Again, because we've had the technical wizardry of Sean Bloy and a few other individuals and the fantastic talents of Maria Caffrey-Harnett and Des Caffrey on the team, that we've been able to blend the sort of technology of film. One of the biggest stars of all is Achill Island. You're asking, you know, Margaret, about sort of coming back. It has been an incredible, strange pandemic. But one of the things I've recognized really for the first time from living here, the longest period I've ever lived in my life here, over a year, is the symphony of nature in Achill. That things change, that the beach that you'll see in Kim Bay, in 2 weeks, the sand dropped 2 feet. Which is like a huge, huge big change. It's all come back, but it's this incredible changes in nature, these incredible storms. And so really the star of the show is definitely Achill Island, which is constant inspiration in terms of its Homeric beauty, really.
Right, and you've got a whole crew of Achill people to help you realize this dream. You've mentioned them, and we're just about to see their work. It's a love letter to a place made by people from the place, and maybe we shouldn't say anything more about it, but just share the film right now. So thank you, Kevin. We'll be back after the film. And just some housekeeping. I've been told, please don't share your screen. Don't fiddle with your controls. Keep yourself on mute. We've been having, you know, a little bit of difficulty as some people enter, et cetera. But we hope that we'll all set up now to just see our film in uninterrupted pleasure. And it's about a 10-minute film. And are you ready to go? Are we ready to go? All right. Play.
We may bring Lord a rare Coril Croyal Mochery.
Back out on the island. Back where it all begins again. That old green tide still turns up regular on the appointed hour. Surfing in the bright air, streaming silver green. Well springing up over jagged edge, breaking to shore, gushing between ancient rocks. The heft and weave of silver foamy waters, shaking the ramparts of this old citadel, rocking the lives between. The swelling waters pregnant in their fill, coursing through inlet and pool, cascading deep inland, caressing bog, mud, and peat, gliding mute past roof and wreck, the broken open stone walls that birthed an exiled nation, with their grasses and lichen and their death flowers' sooty nettle beds, ruins that linger on long, long after their native souls departed, taking flight, east or west. Then those eternal waters on their ebb, leeching away, running back over mirrored grey cloud sandy beach, gathering up the strewn lot, the tidal pool sucking sand, kelp, pebble, seed, heart and hope, back out beneath your feet, draining slipstream into an ocean of memory, rippling away, fathom beyond fathom deep, far out, so far from shore that you could lose all bearing, and never find yourself or your own way home again, except this seed. Tide-born, storm-tossed, cradled across the great ocean, began again. Rooted under another sun, watered by a lake and iron fire, steeled, grew up in other shapes and forms, but knew itself again. Well springing up under porch clapper boards, surging by river, canal, and brick. Seeping out in the heft of a spade, the word on an icy wind, those square-built streets. The skyscraper singing that went on in those prayers for our dead. Down Irish Town, my grandmother said, when she was young. They laid you out on the kitchen table and stopped the clocks, though no one knew the reason why. Mary Lynch. That was her name, my first corpse. Knocked down by a streetcar on West 25th Street. The poor thing. You could see the bruise. She was 11, and I was 10. The waters running river in the freeway flow across the plain. Down on the shoreway in his old blue Chevy. Grandad Mochin would always sing the same sad song, his voice ocean deep. And she laid her hand upon me, and this she did say, oh, it will not be long, love, till our wedding day. The wave inside that connects the voice to heart to hope to green in this our newfound land, or snags its soul on an old threshold of a somewhere in between. And every Sunday after Mass, Uncle Eugene would sit on the porch and read the plain dealer, and then look up and say, God, this whole world has gone to hell in a handcart. What with Kennedy and all them wars and factories closing. And sure wasn't it time he took the boat back to Ireland and climbed Crowpatrick, God's holy mountain, before he was dead. But he never did, and had never been, and ended up buried out in Calvary instead. Old worlds and new, tangling, irrevocable. You know, darling, when you were born, you had this thick mane of brown hair curls, and I said that we should call you Maeve. She was an Irish queen. But your mother, God bless her, said that they would never spell it right, even in the hospital. So we called you Erin instead. Coursing through inlet and pool, cascading deep inshore, gliding mute, reshaping its form, till you are never sure where the waters separate or begin again. Back out on the island, the old green tide still turns up regular on the appointed hour, surfing in the bright air, streaming silver green, breaking wave against the old citadel, rocking the lives between, carrying home to an ocean of memory from its scattered seed, the swirl of longings of newborn lives, at peace, at rest, in exile, at war, and in their dreams. Their voices curled up within the wave, legacies old and new, well springing up over jagged edge, sounding on shore, running eternal in the green, coming home again.
My young love said to me, my mother won't mind, and my father won't slight you for your lack of kind. Then she stepped away from me, and this she did say: it will not be long, love, till our wedding day. She stepped away from me, and she moved through the fair. So fondly I watched her move here and move there. Then she made her way homeward with one star away, as the swan in the evening moves over the lake. We may bring Lodge a rare Caril Croyal Machery, the Wookshi Horatian Nachrafum Lanachesh Lishi Shislam Hiv Hagis Shah Maharaj Nero Ada Gomeva Su Sanot. I dreamt it last night that my dead love came in. So softly she moved that her feet made no din. Then she came close beside me, and this she did say: "It will not be long, love, till our wedding day. Niroada Gomela, or Bosu Sanach."
Welcome back, everyone. I hope you enjoyed, resonated with, felt the emotion of that experience. And just not to be too prosaic, but there's a little bit of anxiety. Some people haven't been able to get on the call, et cetera, et cetera. Just want to tell everyone that the whole thing is being recorded. We'll make it available to rewatch later, and we will find a way to share the film itself with you again, but the film will be embedded in the recording of the whole event as well. So please don't be anxious. You'll have a chance to see it again. I'd like to invite Kevin Toolis back on. Kevin, you need to say hello so that you can get back on the screen so that we can see you in the speaker focus.
Okay, can everyone hear me okay?
Yeah. Yes, Kevin, you're good. Kim, you're good.
Okay.
Good. And I just want to know, so how are we going to do this? What we're going to do is we're going to take questions in chat. We're on three platforms, WebEx, Facebook Live, and YouTube Live. We've got moderators on each of the platforms, and put your questions into the chat function of all those platforms. And the moderators will pass them on to me, and I will ask them of Kevin. Everyone, keep yourself on mute. Don't share screen. Don't fiddle with any controls, etc. So, Kevin, you talked about the fact that this was a love letter to a place, ACL, and it really is. And can you talk a little bit about the inspiration of ACL and how that affects what you've been doing?
So, one of the things I've been doing on the island, apart from learning Irish, is I go sea swimming every day, and I'm on about, like, I don't know, 250 days, or maybe nearly, yeah, maybe over 300. So some of it, really, the beginning of the poem, after Margaret got in contact and we were starting to talk, and this one phrase came into my mind, which was the heft and weave of silver foamy waters. And so that really began this whole notion of the ocean that you hear so much in the poem, and the eternal nature of the tide, that ACL is, I don't even know how long the coastline is, but The island itself is 57 square miles. Maybe we've got like 200 miles of coastline because of all these inlets. And the sea is so much, an ocean is so much a part of the experience of life here. I can hear the wind and the waves every single moment in my house here on Dukanella. I'm just about 100 meters from the sea. And it's such an awesome creation, the power. Even today, we were actually swimming in Kim, where we filmed, where Maria is singing. And the waves were coming in like huge, just walls of water, knocking us off our feet. So that route was really the inspiration. And sometimes when you're on in the swim and you feel the tidal pool underneath your feet sucking, rippling away, sucking sand, kelp, pebbles, seed, heart, and hope back out beneath your feet. And that was all bound up then really with these, obviously these little vignettes of exile, of really, I suppose my own Irish identity began in the company as a child of all these endless aunties. You know, I don't know how, it must be the same in Cleveland. They're not really your aunties. They're not your blood auntie, but they're like your aunties. And it's this sort of communal growing up and these women passing things on. And so these stories, the characters in them. And so the poem, I think, is reflecting that in, you know, like Uncle Eugene and every Sunday after Mass, reading The Plain Dealer, looking up and complaining about the world and et cetera, et cetera. So you have had all these, have a few relatives who, they've never had a day's health in their life, but they're of a very advanced age. So it's like an incredible whole experience. And so that's what I've tried to do, reflect in the poem.
Right. And you can see the knowledge, intimate knowledge of the island on the part of yourself and Sean Malloy, the videographer, in terms of knowing when to capture those moments. We have a question from TJ Malloy on WebEx. TJ's family, very central and important family in Cleveland. His parents, Steve and Annie Malloy, and he contributed one of the photographs to our piece. And he wants to know, basically, what are you influenced by other poets? Did you come to poetry, to this act of poetry through reading other poets? And do you know anything? We have a Cleveland poet, Hart Crane, for example. Do you know anything about American poets that influenced you?
If anyone was a Heaney fan, they would have maybe picked up the reference to Midterm Break. You know, she was 11, I was 10. I also run a show. I'm a member of a band called The Wonders of the Wake, and that's one of the poems that I often recite on stage. I used to read a lot of American literature. I wouldn't feel qualified to say I knew much about kind of American poetry. I suppose one of the biggest creative influences on my life would really be James Joyce. And even at the last paragraph of The Dubliners, I'm sure everyone's familiar with it, but in The Dead, and it's just the kind of cadences within Joyce. So, and I, in one way, I never really know where these things come from. And one of the things which I'm eternally grateful to the Society for, and you, Margaret, is, you know, when you're sort of commissioning something, as you did, you know, to commission a bardic poem is totally so fantastic. I worked as a filmmaker, I've commissioned lots of people to do different things. Up until now, no one's ever, it's the second bardic poem commission in my life. But somehow in the act of commissioning, you begin to shape and form something that wouldn't exist without the commission. So I'm very thankful for that. And hopefully the poem does justice and faith in that commission.
Right. And
I'm not sure if I answered TJ's question, but.
That's okay. And yes, the commission coming from us, calling you out to sort of connect specifically with Cleveland, maybe more at the end than you originally intended. And the way that you integrated the images from Cleveland was very effective and powerful as well. We have a question from Stephen O'Sullivan, also from the WebEx platform. It's kind of a long question, but it's about being an immigrant and the call of coming home. And he says, where does this call spring from? Do you suppose it's the same with the lives of other immigrants coming from other countries? How universal is this sense, or is it particular to the Irish sensibility to long for home?
I think there's no answer to that question. It obviously depends on the particular sort of group. And clearly, you know, in a nation of immigrants like in America or Britain has a huge number of immigrants too. So people do bring their cultures with them. One of the most famous aspects of British cooking is Indian restaurants. But people have brought their culture. They're carrying things with them. And we all do carry the culture in which we originated from. Maybe there's something, you know, Ireland is a really old culture. It is a really old culture, and it has a kind of walls, and sometimes it can be hard to define what exactly that culture. We think of music, but there is this, somehow a kind of like a depth to it, you know, that is, we see it in kind of Irish literature, Irish poetry. It's usually a kind of fairly positive nationality to come from. So there maybe is something in the, you know, the Irish culture. I think if you're thinking in the American experience, you know, huge numbers of Germans immigrated to America, sometimes even more Germans than the Irish, but the vessel of the culture doesn't seem to hold itself for that particular immigrant. We don't look on, I don't know how often people talk about the German-American experience. We talk about the Irish-American experience. But you're all much more qualified to talk about that than me, so I'll defer.
It's a hard question, but there certainly seems that there's a strong sense of connection among Irish-Americans in Ireland, between Irish-Americans in Ireland, and maybe we won't call it unique, but strong. Okay, I have a question from Louis Finucane. Have you found a peacefulness in returning to Achill and its innate wildness, the way in which John O'Donohue found inspiration amid his native Connemara?
I'd say the island punishes and the island rewards. It's not kind of paradise, and it's neither paradise in terms of the people or in the awesomeness of nature is incredible. You know, the number of storms we've just come through, I don't know, like a month of storms. It's amazing power, amazing sort of rainfall. And so I wouldn't say I found a kind of peace, but I recognize the virtues of the place. And I don't feel, I used to be on the road a lot. I used to, you know, travel a lot. I went around the Middle East a lot when I was making all those films. But I'm pretty happy being here in Achill. I really am.
Must be strange, though. You made the decision to move back, and then when we're hit with a global pandemic and been in COVID lockdown for much of this time. And in fact, one of our listeners on the WebEx platform, James Gallagher, is asking, how is the island? How do you deal with something like COVID on an island, a small place like Achill?
Well, during the winter, everything sort of closes up anyway. So last year, I wrote a small TV series for TG Carr, and one of the critics said, it's about a place called Achill where people have been practicing self-isolation for decades. So things do shut down, you know, the pubs close or they close, you know, they don't open in the same way. So in one way, we've all sort of been prepping forever for a global pandemic.
But you're obviously well positioned.
You miss, it'd be lovely to be the going up to town, going on, you know, fantastic shopping expeditions for 35 miles. It would be lovely, you know, to sit down and have a pint and have a meal. Some friend was saying that they used to go up to Westport from Ackle, and then they'd spend the night. Like, it was just, hey, it's like a resort. And one of the difficulties now is that you can hardly go to the toilet in Westport because there's no place open. There's not a cafe, there's not a restaurant, there's not a pub. You can just shop and then come back to Ackle. So we're all missing out in bits, but at the same time, there's just this incredible, you know, I can walk out onto a 3 mile beach. I can kind of climb mountains. You're not confined physically to a sort of city, going around a park or something right. like that. There's right. space, but yeah. obviously you're mm-hmm. still missing out on the social connections you would have from a pub or meeting up or doing any kind of communal social event.
We are too. We've got a question from Emily on the Facebook platform and wants to know more about the song that is such a centerpiece in the film. The significance of it. Tell us a little bit more about that.
To the fair.
Yes.
I'm not an expert, but it's a very old Irish air. The words are, I think, come from, I've forgotten the name of the man, but it's from 1911. It's quite an unusual rhythm. And obviously when she, I don't know if people notice, but in the little version I sing rather badly myself on the hillside, there are so many different versions, but it's the one that I kind of heard, you know, she laid her hand upon me. But the one that Maria Harnett Cafferkey sings, it doesn't contain that line. But essentially, it's sort of like a ghost story, you know, when she says she moved with them in me and her feet made no din, that she's a ghost. And then she's actually saying, it will not be long, love, till our wedding day. But it's his death that is the wedding day. And so it's a kind of foretelling. So it's a very haunting, foreboding, really, but hopefully, you know, on the film, you can get this incredible expression, and it's I find it a really moving icon. It brings back so many personal memories hearing that song. It just sort of conjures up the past. So that's when we chose that. Quite interestingly, we added a verse in Gaeilge.
I wanted to talk about that.
So there's various versions, and you can have huge orchestrated versions, and Sinead O'Connor, you pick it up on YouTube, and she's almost like the Dublin Symphony Orchestra behind her. But we picked on a very bare rendition based upon a singer from the 1960s, a woman called Anna Briggs. But Maria's really just got such an incredible voice. So we recorded that. And we just Maria's voice. And so the rendition that you hear, and then the actual Gaeilge, we checked it with our sage on the island, John Twin McNamara. Because one of the things I'm really interested in is Achill Irish, which is like unique. So the version that you heard is actually never really been done before in Achill Irish. But that's the particular blend of elements of both the English, the purity of Maria's voice, the actual intonation in Achill Irish, and the last line. So it's a wonderful, and all praise to the society, is that that's one of the little things that we've recreated or created for the first time. Even in that song, you'd probably, it would never have been sung like that before. And one thing for absolutely sure, it would never have been sung in such a beautiful location, Kimbay.
Right. So,
again, right. I thank you all for your foresight and courage in commissioning the work.
Well, we have a question from Kathleen Dorsey on the WebEx platform as well. And she's asking about the virtues of, I presume, Ackle. And one thing that it strikes me is that you have a knowledge of who you can call on to collaborate, but you also have the people there that you can collaborate with. Can you talk a little bit about your collaborators and how you engage them in the process?
Well, all filming starts with a filmmaker. So I've got experience of filmmaking, but I'm not a kind of technical person. And so really that was Sean Malloy, who's done, you know, fantastic. I've never worked with a kind of filmmaker who can film and then carry a drone around on his back as he's filming the sequence in the water at the same time. And so, you know, the film, I've made films for 25 years. Maybe the very, if you see it again, when it's played again, it is a really beautiful work of film. The scenes, the places where they've been, the landscape, the devices that we've used, the inclusion of the, you know, both the fusion of pictures, stills, even the historic film of Cleveland, which comes from a US government film called Steel Town from 1944. And then I think very powerfully evocative, the stills of all the families and people who took part and offered to give their pictures, which again, we are really grateful for. So it's the fusion of those elements of both music, location. We were also blessed with the most amazing weather when we were doing our shoot on Kim. It had been just endless storms. And the forecast said there'd be 4 hours of sunshine on Saturday morning. And I just couldn't believe it. I just thought that's just not true. And it turned out to be like it was like the biggest, most expensive Hollywood show ever. The sun came and you'll actually see, if you look at the film again, you can see our shadows. The sun is so powerful and so bright. It's like the most incredibly expensive Hollywood movie lighting system. Just there, right. Just for 4 hours. And then it began to rain again. So yeah. It was fantastic.
Okay, so crazy weather, great collaborators, and we'd love to talk more about the drone, but I think we need to talk a little bit about the deserted village as location. Not everyone might be familiar with that. And how you integrated it so well into your film.
So one of the things about the deserted village, but really all over the island, when I've talked about this island of perpetual exile, and I know, Margaret, even that your old family home is still there. The broken open stone walls that birthed an exiled nation. That you in other places, people, they just get knocked down or they just disappear. But the island is littered with what you might call these twin gabled-ended tombstones enclosing departure and loss. Every nail, wire, and stick strewn like a relic across this island of perpetual exile, their seed scattered across the face of the earth. In my own village of Ducanella, there's the ruins of the old village of Ducanella too. But probably nowhere else in Ireland do you have such a concentration of houses as in the deserted village on the slopes of Slievemore. There's even two other villages which have now completely engulfed by gore, so you can't see them from the air. But the shot that Sean took of the drone, you get a sense of how large these communities were. There's something like 137 stone-built ruins still there. On that hillside, which is, again, it's really amazing, there are lots of megalithic tombs. There are Bronze Age tombs. Some of the Bronze Age farms have been incorporated into this relatively modern village of the 1800s. So the stones and the human lives that were played out on that hillside really reach back over 6,000 years. So it's a very special place. And the fact that it exists, it's not a theme park, it exists very, very close to its natural state. I mean, you can see that the picture of the men, which this was Sean's brilliant technique of finding that picture and then matching it to, now that picture was taken in the 1940s. So some of the houses were still being inhabited. What they call bully houses or bawley houses, so that people would come in the summer with their animals and would come back to the village. They think the village was abandoned not long after the famine in the 1840s, but people still continued to use the houses as a sort of like summer dwelling. So you get a sense of that in that fantastic sequence where you can see those men repairing the thatch on the house, but the ruins and the stones are there still, like, you know, 80, 100 years, the exact same stones. We could match the picture with the stones right in front of us. And so there's that untouchedness about it that makes it a very powerful, evocative place.
Right. And we've got Vincent English, one of your fellow islanders, referenced the fact that you've been doing some tours of the colony and hopes that you're going to be making a film based on those tours about the...
Vincent is a real expert.
Yes, I know. And we've also got, we don't have time for too many more questions, but we've got two more. Patrick Murphy alludes to your phrase from My Father's Wake, taking the weight. You talked about taking the weight of responsibility to tell the story. And you were talking literally at that time about the straps to lower your father in the grave. And Patrick says, I thought you meant a lot more than that figuratively. Can you expound? How is coming home again, taking the weight, an example of your taking the weight?
The weight. Well, maybe for everyone who's not read the book, one of the things that is enacted within this ancient Irish culture, particularly around death, is that sort of literal and figurative and psychological taking the weight. That when somebody dies, instead of running to the other side of the street, that people actually come in as a community. And there are certain literal moments where people do take the weight. You know, and one of the most important ways of taking the weight is to actually carry the coffin of your dead. I mean, sometimes you can get in the undertaking industry, you know, it's pall bearing and it's another service. But I see that as both a kind of honor, and certainly on the island, there are no professional pall bearers. It's an honor to be asked to take the weight of another mortal, the coffin. And one of the things that they explain that is that there's this Irish phrase called a mihel. So when I was young, my grandfather, his haymaking, when he was taking in the hay, the neighbors lent their labor on the special day, just as he would lend his labor to them. So it's a kind of mutual, it's not an act of pure altruism, but it's an act of social trust. And so when you carry the coffin, you are engaged in a transcendental mihel. You might see from this face and stuff like that, one day, just as I've recently carried my aunt in my community, just as I carry my sister or brother today, I too will be carried in the future by someone else in my community. Hopefully those yet unborn. I don't think so, but I am. So really, it's this, I'm doing this service as part of my communal obligation to my brother or my sister, just as I hope that they will do their communal service to me. I'm not doing it for money. I'm only doing it for the honor. So taking the weight, and then just literally at the last moment, after the grave is always dug here, still dug by volunteers, a perpetual quorum of men from the village. Again, it's an honor to be asked. There's always that last moment when the coffin's been laid over the open grave and the pallbearers have got the ropes in their hand, and the chief grave digger literally says, take the weight. And so they then pull up. They have to pull up together. You can't drop the coffin down by yourself. You have to rely on your fellow pallbearers together to take the weight. The sleepers are pulled out, and then they gradually, slowly lower this down to the bottom of the grave. And so it's a perfect example of that we're sharing in the burden and joy of our mortality with others, that we're recognizing the other as part of the same human community. So I hope that in the poem you recognize that too, in the uncles and in the sometimes the cultural misunderstandings and the names that you give to your children or whatever.
Can you tell us that the Irish word that you're using for that responsibility again, and maybe spell it for us?
A mehel. Yeah. It's M-E-I-T-H-E. I think it's probably Fada L. Maybe I'm not sure. But it's pronounced mehel. And it means, so again, going back to what was happening with my grandfather, is that when you were taking in all the hay to his house on the day, you had a kind of squad of men who were lending their labor, but obviously in the expectation that he would return that. I think the Amish do the same. You see it in the kind of pictures where they're all doing the barn together. It's that kind of communal labor.
Okay, one last question, really quick. What's your next project up? Kenneth Lynch from North Carolina wants to know.
I was just talking with Sean. There's a chance that in this centenary of commemorations that we might make a film commemorating the War of Independence in Mayo. If anyone would like to support it, it'd be a great idea. But we are thinking of doing another little kind of Homeric poem.
Absolutely.
That is a sort of focus on that particular period of history, and then both the outcome, and been a lot of kind of conflict situations. So we're thinking about that. That's our next project. Yep.
Okay, we're going to transition to the next part of our program. I want to thank you very much, Kevin, for sharing your work with us and sharing your thoughts. I think we're going to everybody can stay on the platforms that they're on. We're going to move into music and raffle pulling and raffle buying and selling and pulling in a second. First, we're going to have Tom Corrigan come back. I think Kevin Toolis is staying on chat in the WebEx platform. And welcome, Tom, back to the MCC.
Thank you, Margaret. I'm beaming with pride. The Irish American Archives Society was so proud to commission the Johnny Kilbane sculpture, Fighting Heart. And we researched and produced that wonderful, the day we celebrate 175 years event of St. Patrick's Day parades. And now we have Coming Home Again to add to our accomplishments. And for those who didn't hear Margaret before, the film will be available on the website so that you'll be able to see it again. Share it again if you like. I do want to basically say that, Kevin, I cannot tell you how much I personally appreciate what you did. It's just fabulous. Just fabulous. Of course, I'm in a celebratory mood, and when you'd have a celebration, you'd like to have some proud music. And we're very happy to say that Cleveland's own Porter Sharks, who did the music at the introduction, will be joining us, and I hope you'll stay and join with us. I know we're going to let Kevin go off camera if he wants, but he did say that he would stay available on the chat. But this is a fundraiser. As you know, this is the substitute for our Walks of Life dinner, which funds all those things that we've been doing at the Irish American Archives Society. So I hope you'll click the places on the screen. I hope you'll pat yourself on the back if you've already helped us out. And of course, the raffle tickets are still available. And so at least for the next half hour, the four baskets of cheer and the book basket. And I want to emphasize, we can only accommodate deliveries within Northeast Ohio, but anyone all over the world can make a donation. So we're hopeful that you'll help us support our historic mission of preservation. And so donate, buy raffle tickets. And at this point, let's cue up the Porter Sharks and again hear their wonderful music.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are going to play some tunes for the Irish American Archives. And we're going to start with a few reels. So here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4. Thank you.
And the great white shark himself is up next.
The great white shark. A little ruffled at the end of the
day.
Hey, it's good to see you.
Lovely to be here tonight, isn't it?
And we're here for the Irish Archive Society.
The Irish American Archives Society. In Cleveland.
Let's get it right, lads.
That's right.
And we're having a great night.
I'm playing the fiddle, he's playing the guitar.
And you're welcome. My dad was a miner and his granddad was tin. There was never much question about what he might tin. By the age of 13, he'd laid down his pen and become a coal miner and a prince among men. My goal as a young man in a bright early age was to follow my hero down in that cage. Fairy lights and cocoons were the stuff of my dreams. Never thinking how hard my dad would have to see. Song Billy's going to do that was made famous by Elvis Costello, Nee Declan McManus. If on every ocean a ship is a throne, and for each mast a bow, another sapling is grown. Power.
legendary accordion player from Galway who just passed away yesterday. And the second tune will be The Rights of Man.
Starting it out.
and the Irish community lost a great fife and drum player and educator. His name was Tony Molloy, and we're going to do this next song in tribute to Tony, who helped so many kids learn the fife for the past probably 40 years. So we're going to do Gary Owen for him. A 1, 2, 3. So we're going to have a song here from Billy Chambers, great man over here from the very near West Side, a golf stroke from the harp. What are we going to do, Billy?
It used to be a 9-iron, now it's a 7-iron. We're going to do a song called The Roseville Fair.
Fill the air so long.
this next song reminds us of our old friend, Steve Malloy, who spent a long time raising money in this town for various causes. And one of his causes was a lifeboat for Atoll Island. And this song will make you think of that.
On a cold winter night, when the storm at its height, the lifeboat and I circled along. As she pitched, she tossed, we thought she was lost, as we launched from the harbor wall. Though the night was pitch black, there was no turning back, for someone was waiting out there. And the lifeboat was here, and the lifeboat was here.
Your plan.
Thank you so much to the Porter Sharks for brightening our afternoon. We reached 60 degrees here in Cleveland in the late afternoon, and we thank them for brightening our day. And for those listening overseas, we hope you're having a good evening. This is an incredible gathering of people over four platforms, WebEx, Facebook, YouTube, and What's On in ACL. We're so proud of hearing from the people of ACL who have joined us today. This has been made possible by so many people, and we'll be able to thank most of them on screen or in writing. But I do want to point out that we're live here at Gormley's Pub in Rocky River. And thanks to Sean Gormley for hosting us. And you may have recognized the Porter Sharks background. They tape their sessions at the Harp in Cleveland, thanks to Karen O'Malley. And Casey's Irish Imports, a few doors down, helped pull the raffle baskets together for us. We'll give a few more shout-outs at the end of the program, but we especially want to thank Patrick Custy of the Porter Sharks for volunteering his know-how to bring all these components together today. Thank you so much, Patrick. And we know you want to hear who won the baskets of cheer, and the purchases are coming in quickly. So we're going to cut it off at this point, though, in the next 30 seconds, and go to the Porter Sharks for a closing set. And we want to remind everybody that you'll be able to continue to donate for some days after our live session here, as you look on Facebook or YouTube Live. And obviously, as I said before, this is a fundraiser to keep the work of the Irish American Archives Society in place. Thank you so much. Let's go with another set from the Porter Sharks. And thank you so much.
Well, this next song we'd like to do for you now is a song called The Green and Red of Mayo. The reason we picked those colors is because those are the two colors on the Mayo flag.
Mayo. cabin.
Not
Dublin. Montclair.
Up Flanner.
Dublin, Cavan.
The Summit.
And all the other counties that we
have. Donegal.
We're going to do a tune called Danny Boy. And this was requested by Colleen Corrigan O'Malley.
I'll see you next time.
What will we play now after that? Really has a song, it sounds like.
No,
let's play Tom Byrne's tune, The Battering Ram. You love
The Battering Ram.
The Battering Ram for Tom Byrne.
Let's do it.
The Battering Ram.
Alright. One, two, ready, go.
Thank you. the lights are low. Forget about the troubles of morning.
Thank you.
Quinn, everybody.
Woo!
Here's a song called The Morning Glory, followed by another song called After Hours. We're going to play this song called The Ashokan Farewell that was written by a fiddler named Jay Unger back in the early 90s, I believe. But this is a great song, And Nikki and I will play this.
Thank you.
was brilliant.
Let Tom go first.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much. The Porter Sharks, they've been great. They've played at so many of our events over the years, and it's always great to have them play for us and to hear them. And now the moment you've been waiting for, we're going to announce the raffle winners. And I want to invite Tom Scanlon to the mic. He's going to share the names of the winners, but most importantly, as one of the longest serving Irish American Archive Society board members, Tom, as I frequently call him, our fearless leader. And this project and the Johnny Kilbane project and the Parade Book project would not have happened without him. So I'm happy to let him announce. And I should point out, he's a whiskey aficionado. So one of the baskets was of interest to him. Tom.
Thank you, Tom. The only reason I'm the longest is that I'm the oldest. Nothing to do with the years of service. Well, we do have the winners. And there are some really interesting things in these baskets. And the fact of the matter is I have an interest in Irish whiskey, and it will be shared in some of the baskets. So the first winner is Kathleen Dorsey. Are they going to have basket number one?
She gets to pick each basket.
If you call me, we might give you some advice. First one that calls, we'll get the advice. The second winner is Kathleen Gallagher. Third winner is Cindy Rother. Fourth winner is a good friend of our executive directors. Fine man that I've known for many years, Bill Gibbons. And the final winner, a man that goes back many generations, and in fact, I had the pleasure of being with him when he was made the Mayo Man of the Year, Bill Conway. These are the winners. Thank you all for your support. Every dollar we need goes to our mission. Our mission is to preserve and maintain the heritage of the Irish in Cleveland. Thank you, Tom.
Thank you, Tom. I want to sincerely thank you for sharing this afternoon with us. Basically, we just don't exist. We can't care to protect and defend for the Irish history of this community without your help and support. We're just so grateful. We're going to close with a wonderful Irish-American blessing and a final song from the Porter Sharks. I do want to thank again our presenting sponsor, Irish Ambassador to Ireland, Edward Crawford, for his support. Thank you so much, and enjoy your evening.
We send many blessings to you and to those you hold dear. May the light break through the dark clouds of winter and brighten your heart with joy and peace.
Ladies and gentlemen, we've been live streaming from the Harp with your proprietor here, Karen O'Malley, and she's been gracious enough to let us use the place to do more than one live stream event. She will be opening up on March 2nd, and we hope that after this pandemic that people will be able to come down to the Harp and see live music or have a nice meal. But in the meantime, we would like to sing our parting song called
A Health to the Company.
So here we go.
And you're all the company. We'd like to wish you all a health and the best of luck in the new year. Kind friends and companions, come join me in rhyme. Come lift up your voices in chorus with mine. Come lift up your voices, all grief to refrain.
For we may, or might never, all meet here again. So here's a help to the company, and one for my lass. Let's drink and meet merry up to one glass. Let's drink.
That I love so well. In style and in beauty, sure there's none can excel. With a smile on her countenance as she sits upon my knee. Sure, there's no man in this wide world as happy as me.
So here's a help to the company, and one for my lass. Let's drink and be merry up to one glass. Let's drink and be merry, I'll drink to refrain. For we may or might never all meet here again.
Our ship lies at anchor, she's ready to dock. I wish her a safe landing without any shock. And if ever I should meet you by land or by sea, I will always remember your kindness to me.
So here's a help to the company, and one for my lass. Let's drink and be merry up to one glass. Let's drink and be merry, all drink to refrain. For we may or might never all meet here again.
And the Harp!
And the Harp! Thank you for the Irish American Society Archives.
Shara Mahagath.